I constantly find myself going back to scrolling mindlessly on TikTok, right? And it's like it, my sometimes like I just have to do that. It's like, or else I'm not gonna be relaxed. But
dopamine.
But I like when I wake up in the morning, or like even when I go to sleep, I don't feel at peace. You know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But how do I stop?
Well, one thing, I mean, should you stop? It's part of your ministry.
I know, that's... I know. But it could done in a much less...
I thought you had like a curfew for that. Didn't you tell me about that?
It was a phase.
Wait, can I say a fun fact about Father Danny that I learned last week? Last week?
Come on, mm-hmm. Dude.
Only last week, can I say it?
Yeah, say whatever you want. I have nothing to hide. Can you please tell everyone the truth about bone broth?
Have you been waiting to say this?
Yes.
Since I got sick? You're waiting for me to get sick, right?
No.
He didn't even send a
text. Just admit it.
Yeah.
Just not admit that. It. You were waiting for me to get sick?
Just tell the world.
Say, I told you.
Wait. So was there like a claim that because you've been drinking bone broth for so long that you just never get sick?
There was indeed a claim. Yeah.
Okay.
There was
indeed. And it has been debunked now.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
But I'm glad to see you.
That's been debunked by you for everything. Huh?
A lot of garlic.
Essential oils.
You're the king of phases. Honestly. You and Father Andy. Father Andy has a lot of phases too.
So, however, I will say one thing though. Honestly, the sickness was short and sweet. 2 days. Compared to how it used to be for me. Like, you guys remember, I used to get hit
months
bad.
At a time, yeah.
Bad. So now, it's better. I'm going to still continue the bone broth, in case you were wondering. Because it's good for you.
Okay, good.
Doesn't taste good at all, though. But, you know.
You got to put hot sauce in it, that's it.
Hot sauce?
Yeah.
That's actually not a bad idea, but it's the first thing in the morning, you know. I just shoot it down. It
wakes you up.
Yeah. What else is going on?
Why can't people just be normal and have coffee?
I do have coffee as well, but coffee is like the dessert after, you know? Like it's like, tastes even better after.
Do a food review on bone broth, bro.
Maybe we can have some here. Yeah.
No? San Diego Padres are on
San Diego
fire.
Padres, yeah. By the time people are watching this, they could be headed to the NLDS.
NLCS,
sorry, to the National League Championship Series. Hopefully.
Inshallah, man.
I think they're just going to finish it in San Diego, dude. 2 games, don't go back to LA. What do you think,
this
Father Abbott?
This team can do it. They're capable.
I just learned today that there's a game tonight in San Diego.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. So I have no opinions on the matter.
You're into football, right? Green Bay? You're a Green Bay fan, right?
Yeah, when I was a kid. I still am.
Okay,
I think it's a duty of any clergyman to at least be interested in the Padres because of the mascot and because of what they represent and the heritage and the tradition behind it. You don't see other mascots, you know, paying homage to the Catholic tradition. So for you to not be interested in the Padres is to take something away from your
it's
faith.
It's a venial sin,
and
probably.
And you're a monk, by the way.
Not a Franciscan, though.
Not a Franciscan.
But it doesn't matter. Religious.
Yeah, I'm technically not a friar, actually.
You're disrespecting the consecrated life by not liking the Padres.
I'm protesting.
Can I ask you guys something, though? Like, on a serious note, do you guys pray for the Padres to win? Like...
I'll be honest.
Do you pray during mass for Manny Machado to hit a grand slam?
No.
Absolutely not.
To be honest with you, if I'm watching the game and things are getting a little tough, I'll make a sign of the cross.
Yeah. I'm not going to say who, but I've seen a priest bless a player during a game as they were walking up to hit. Like from
a professional player?
Yeah, from a distance. Like, you know? Like.
So how did he do that inning?
I don't remember, but I've seen that happen.
Interesting.
Yeah. Going to games, I've only been a few times.
You were
for like Catholic night, Catholic night, that kind of thing. Oh my gosh, I really can't.
But we had the nosebleed seats.
Oh, dude. No. just the environment. I absolutely
hate not with it. The but Padres.
You, yeah. But remember NFL games? Have like did you go to Charger games back in the day?
Been to two in my life.
Because those are like
trashy, man.
Yeah, crazy. Like too much. You'd much rather sit home on your couch and watch the game, you know?
Yeah.
But the Padres, when you're into it, bro, like this environment.
Isn't Jackson Merrill a good Catholic?
I don't know. But he's such a good, humble guy, man.
Yeah.
I like when Jason Adam comes into the game. Yeah. His walk-up song is used as gospel by Kanye West. It's just a good song. And the guy has like, you know, a cross around his neck. It's pretty cool to see.
You know, I love to see people in the spotlight, whether it's sports, the whatever, film industry, like Mark Wahlberg, you know? He uses his platform not to
stay blessed. What did he say? Happy Sunday, everybody. Stay blessed.
Something like that.
Stay prayed up.
Yeah.
Stay prayed up.
It really gets people like to think about, you know, religion and Catholicism and, you know, why are these people so into it? There must be something, you know, interesting.
I do like also how Mario Lopez, who's his friend, you know, expresses his Catholicism and stuff like that. But the guy is a diehard Dodgers fan.
I know.
And he's from Chula Vista.
He's that's sad. That is
what a
disgrace.
Disgrace.
Yeah.
What a tragedy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What?
Jerima, right? What a crime. What a crime. Man, when you laugh like that, it's very funny. It makes it even funnier.
Yeah, so, okay, I want you guys to react to this video I saw. It's an advertisement for Apple. They have... it was a little while ago. I've been meaning to show you guys this since last season, by the way, okay?
Okay,
merci. And I'm going to show you guys today. It's an advertisement for their new... I think it's the new iPad, all right? So check this out.
Like the one you have?
No, this is the old iPad.
All right, check it out.
Everybody can see here?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah? Yeah. You can see? All right, ready? Interesting, huh?
So what stood out to you about it? Like, why did you want to share it?
Just because of the, you know, culture of, you know, technology use and them saying that all, you know, like there was a bunch of cultural references. Mm-hmm. I know you guys were sitting far, but there was, you know, books, there was art, there was, you know, cinema, a bunch of stuff. And they were all containing in this one little device. So my question is like, what effect does that have on people nowadays with those devices? Because all of that is contained. Like, you know, you can access everything with your device now. And so what effect is that having on people nowadays, you know?
Well, off the bat, I don't think it's anything new. You know, our phones have always contained, you know, books to read and, you know, search engines and whatever. But the only thing that would sort of be alarming to me is that they're not explicitly saying that now all of these things are contained in this one device, but rather these, like, they're visibly showing that these things are being destroyed.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
that's true.
Which is kind of eerie, to be honest with you, because
that's the feeling I felt, like an eerie feeling watching that.
You know, what it also reminded me of is, any dictator would know this, like the burning of the books. You do that so people do not educate themselves, so they don't overthrow the government or, you know, their power and stuff. And I mean, that's a scary thing, you know, to think that technology is destroying all of these things, literature, whatever it may be, that could help someone grow in knowledge and educate themselves, you know, to just make society at a less of a caliber of where they should be, just so there's more control for the technological companies on them.
I wish they would have, because I'm not in principle opposed to the iPad or even doing like art or reading. I mean, I read on a Kindle as much as I can because it's because of the convenience, you know. I'm not one of those guys that says I have to smell the book or whatever. It's very convenient to read on a Kindle, or even on my, I wrote most of my thesis on my phone, to be completely honest with you, you know, highlighting and taking notes and doing all that stuff. So I'm not in like in principle opposed to use of any of that stuff. And even digital art is really beautiful, I think. It's good. But yeah, the way that they presented it is that technology is going to replace all these other things. Digital art is going to replace hand paintings. You know, that's why you have like the buckets of paint, they're being crushed and spilled out and things like that in that commercial. And all you have left is the iPad, which is saying that there's no need to hand paint things anymore or to sculpt things anymore. You know, you can do it all. You can do it all just on the iPad through technology, which if they would have presented it as this is in addition to all the stuff that we've been doing before, that I think would have been cool. But they're doing it as a replacement, which is kind of a little bit eerie. You know, it's a bit Gnostic. Gnostic meaning like we're let's say graduating from material reality, and we're just existing in this kind of digital or kind of like fake reality, this new reality that we've created for ourselves.
Meta-world.
Like the metaverse, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So in addition to that, the way that the narrator described it at the end is the most powerful iPad. So it's whatever Father Enkidu just described is being labeled as powerful. Not only is it we're going to replace the mode by which we're receiving these kinds of art and stuff, but this is powerful. It's powerful to get rid of the, or to replace the, you know, previous forms of consumption of art. It's one thing to do that, but this is actually a powerful thing to do, which is branding it as a good thing to do. So it shows like kind of where the mindset of a certain part of society is heading. So what was it, like a few weeks ago, I was hanging out on a Sunday night here at the monastery. I don't know how this conversation got started, and it turned out to be one of the best conversations I've had probably or listened to. Me and Father Enkidu were speaking about this subject somehow, and then some of the monks were also saying some stuff about it. But like, at what point does it benefit and also hurt the human being to use technology to get through reality, to consume reality, or to replace reality with a different kind of world or creation that doesn't necessarily, I don't know how to describe it, correlate with what a human being, how a human being should be living. So there's good, like Father Enkidu was saying, there's good things about digital art. There's good things about using the iPad for convenience or the Kindle or any other similar product. But at what point does it get to harming a human being by getting that human being to creating a different world that takes away from dealing with the things that actually affect human nature?
Well, now it makes it more of a struggle. Like, if we're going to base it off of that, for the receiver to go out of their way to go out and actually go get physical books and read them, force themselves to read them, go out and make sure you're planning your day based off of, you know, having limited screen time, things like that. So I think to find the balance between replacing or destroying all of these beautiful things with a screen, we have to go the opposite direction to find the balance. You have to, because you're going against a grain, you know? And I think if you don't become that extreme, like sometimes I make it a point, if I'm praying, you know, morning prayer or something on my own, I try to make it a point to not use the app and just pray out of the Emmanuel, like small things like that. So.
Or to like actually hold a rosary and go through the beads, you know?
Yeah.
This was happening a lot during, you know, and I think a lot of these questions came up during the COVID lockdown, when people were at home and not able to come to church, and then you have to watch mass online, but you're watching, but you're not receiving the Eucharist and you're not actually with the community, right? So.
Because we were relating this also to like video games.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, video games are a lot of fun. But there's this, I don't know, when you're really deep into a video game, you're essentially living in that world. Like your whole awareness and your whole consciousness is pretty much consumed by that thing that you're doing. Or like when you watch a movie, you know, when you watch a movie, mm-hmm. you're quite unaware of the immediate reality that's around you, you know, and you're so zoned into that movie, your whole awareness is there, you know, and you're kind of living in that space. That's the genius of these mediums. And we were talking about, well, how healthy is it to do that, to escape reality and enter into this other created reality, you know, man-made reality based on the mind of an author or the mind of a director or something like that. How healthy is it to do that often? Mm. You know? And that's kind of related to even that commercial, because that commercial is all about, let's escape this more primitive form of reality, which is material reality, and live on this kind of higher sphere in digital reality. There, things are more convenient, it's easier, it's better, cleaner.
Could I give you some pushback? What if someone were to tell you, okay, but you could say the same about having a different reality when you're reading a good sci-fi?
Yeah, and that's exactly what we brought up too.
Yeah. So we brought up Lord of the Rings,
yeah,
which is a totally different kind of media, totally different yeah. kind of book, literary work compared to most of the things, let's say, that are available. Why? Because of the very, not only blatant, but obviously fruitful Christian yeah. themes and imagery that we see in the book. I haven't read it as extensively as probably you guys have. So like, for example, like what would be something that would distinguish Lord of the Rings compared to another media to demonstrate the fact that some kinds of, you know, supplements to the natural order of things are actually there to enhance the natural order?
I mean, I would say as far as like that book in general, but we can talk mm-hmm. about books more generally. Books kind of can have that same effect if they're gripping enough, like if they're exciting mm-hmm. and they really kind of take you into the story, then it has that same effect. Now, I'm still thinking about it, like whether this is a good or a bad thing, you know, or if it's kind of neutral. I don't think anything's neutral, but whether it's a good or a bad thing, being taken into a story so much so that you're kind of living in that reality now. Now this would be like reading Lord of the Rings or watching it in a movie. Let's just say reading Lord of the Rings, you're taken into the world that Tolkien created.
Yeah.
You know, and when you're reading the book and you're really reading it focused, you know, you're in that story. You're with, you know, Sam and all these characters.
Treebeard.
You know, yeah.
Treebeard,
yeah. Okay. You're with all these characters and you're rooting for them and you're like wondering what's going to happen next. And you're kind of just like, your awareness is totally taken into that story.
But I think if it's something innocent like that, it could be seen as a type of leisure, you know, the balance between work and leisure. Because, I mean, even Jesus in his parables.
Yeah,
but again, this is obviously to a different caliber, but it's that same idea where he wants them to be inside of that reality. And he's walking them through this parable, trying to help them reach this end goal for them to understand, you know?
Yeah, so it's probably not just about right or wrong or like, you know, black and white. It's can you do it in a good way? Because obviously, you know, reading a parable of Jesus or reading scripture, you know, getting into the story of Jesus, this is the highest way that you can escape reality. I mean, you're getting into the reality of God and of the Trinity, right? But there are ways, like with Lord of the Rings, if it's a good Christian story, there are ways to get you there. Right. And so whether
it's overtly Christian or not, does the media enhance what a human being is supposed to be, how a human being is supposed to think and live? So, for example, Lord of the Rings, especially for a Christian, it really points to the themes of, you know, sacrifice and being, nourished by what God has to provide us with, the things like the, you know, the bread of the way of the journey and stuff like that. Let's say it's a video game. Let's say it's another book, a movie. Is what's being provided in that movie, the substance of that movie, helping me understand what it, means to be a human being better, or is it really defining what it means to escape reality and live in another created kind of world?
I think a lot of the escape comes from, because what you're saying right now is ideal, by the way. If someone, I don't know how many people, I could probably count them with one hand, how many people I know that leave a movie and come to some sort of conclusion of a life lesson, a moral, objective that there was in the movie. The majority of people that I know walk into the movie, enjoy it, get absorbed, live in that reality, walk out and say, that was a cool movie, you know? So I think what you're saying is should be the goal, you know? But I think what becomes the most destructive is when people don't put in that same effort that you're mentioning and just completely binge on things, whether it's video games, whether it's scrolling. Yeah. That's where it becomes, someone's mental capacity could be taken over completely. And I know a lot of disasters that have happened with shootings and whatever around, you know, the nation. Some reason, most of the time it ties back to that person was like addicted to their screen with whether it's video games or whatever, and they couldn't get out of that reality anymore.
Yeah, they're living online.
Yeah.
And it's starting when they're very young now. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of our kids are either at school. If they're not at school, maybe they do their homework for a bit, and then they're on TikTok or playing video games for hours and hours a day.
Yeah, and
more than them talking to their family.
I feel bad more than the next person when a parent is having a hard time disciplining their kid, you know, if they're really young and making sure they stop acting out, stop crying. I do feel bad. But this whole idea of, let me just put this iPad or a screen in front of them and they quiet down. And that's sort of a temporary fix for, you know, an hour or something. That's
almost like a drug, right?
Yeah, you know? I mean, I don't know.
It becomes like a addiction for them.
Well, like, okay, the way that you talked about it earlier, somebody goes into a theater, they watch a two-hour movie, they're entertained, they leave, and...
Pure leisure.
Yeah, pure pleasure. Pure pleasure, right?
Yeah. You get the popcorn
both
and...
Yeah. Both and.
Yeah, you know, it's just, you go in there for the sake of the distraction.
I think leisure has more of an intellectual movement behind it, doesn't
like
it?
Like a virtuous.
Yeah, a virtuous thing, disposition. Yeah.
So like reading like Lord of the Rings would be like, or scripture, even reading scripture would be like a leisurely act, you know? Pure entertainment, like going into a video game and playing it for a few hours or whatever, just as a way of, that people will say, unloading or just, you know,
relief.
Yeah, stress relief or whatever it is. As a way of rest, it's not real rest. I don't think it is. I don't think it can be categorized as that. You know, just pure entertainment, just distraction as such, I think is the wrong way of doing it. But I think it's the way that it's being presented today in many ways. That's not to say that technology is bad. You know, we all have plenty of it, right?
Like watching baseball.
Yeah. Okay. Like watching baseball. But
getting
what's
reality.
What's the beauty of watching? I mean, I don't watch baseball, yeah. but I'm gonna watch the game tonight with the monks.
Nice.
Thank you. Why am I going to watch baseball tonight? Not because I have any ties to anything, but because the monks are excited about it and I'm going to be there with them. I'm going to watch it with them.
And it's good for the city, you know?
And it's good for the city.
What are we, chopped liver to you? You've seen how excited we have been. And the only thing for you is the monks are excited, so I'm going to watch
it. He's a good abbot.
So what's the value there? The value there is like... You know, you're with your friends and you're watching a game. That's cool. To me, it's not really the game, you know? I'll watch it with you guys one day.
It's about the friends you made along the way.
But going into a movie and just watching a two-hour movie or a show, like binge watching a show just to see what happens next, like over and over and over again, you're not going to get anything out of that for your moral life or it's not going to, you know, enhance your relationships. It's not going to... make your relationship with God better. It's definitely not going to, I mean, I don't want to speak definitively, but it's probably not going to make you a holier person, right? You're doing it, oftentimes people do it just for the sake of distraction, which is the scary part for me, because it's an escape from God's reality into another reality just so that we're distracted from the true reality over here. That to me is like or a really weird concept.
Okay, I need some brotherly advice from my brothers, okay?
Yes, sir.
So at night, before I sleep, I'd like to relax, okay? And I've gone through times where I have, you know, tried to read a book or something, read scripture or just a book, you know, or you know, listen to a good edifying podcast or something like that. But I constantly find myself going back to scrolling mindlessly on TikTok, right? And it's like my sometimes like I just have to do that. It's like, or else I'm not gonna be relaxed. But
dopamine.
But I like when I wake up in the morning, or like even when I go to sleep, I don't feel at peace, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But how do I stop?
Well, one thing, I mean, should you stop? It's part of your ministry.
I know, I know. But it could be done in a much less...
I thought you had like a curfew for that. Didn't you tell me about that?
It was a phase. It was a phase.
I think it could be something as simple as just finding a good book to read or something. Something that you truly would
reading
enjoy.
Is so boring.
So I think the lack of
peace. Yeah, that's why I said something that you would enjoy.
I think the lack of peace thing is like the more information is in your head, the harder it's going to be to find a sense of peace. I don't know if you guys
you're right.
Agree with that.
And information that has nothing to do
with
you.
With you, yeah.
You know?
And just bam, 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 bam. You know, like you're not watching 1-2 hour long movie.
It's too fast paced.
You're watching a 5 second video.
Wait, is this like, I don't
it's
have
like
TikTok.
Scrolling on either Instagram Reels or TikTok.
There's too much. And
there's a lot.
I don't think the human being was ever meant to know this much at one time.
Mm.
In such a short amount of time. I think it's an abundance.
Yeah.
Yeah, but if you read like, see, that's why like reading books is good, like fiction especially. Reading fiction is really, really good because you're being taken through a story. Like that's a good distraction. You know what we were talking about earlier?
Yeah, but again, it depends on the receiver. If you're willing to do that. Honestly,
you want my true opinion?
Yeah, of course. That's what we're here for.
My true opinion is find the good thing to do. And if it's not for you, make it for you.
Okay.
You know? You make it for you.
I like that. However, let me tell you, reading a book requires me to use my brain power and to concentrate. So it feels like I'm working now. But it's night and I'm about to sleep and I don't want to work. I don't want to you know, do anything. I just want to relax. So that's why like watching a bunch of those videos is easier for me and it seems like it's better for me.
Can I give you a suggestion?
Please.
A really good suggestion.
Yeah.
Okay. Audiobooks have become really, really popular. And listening to an audiobook is the same. I mean, I don't know how it changes it like epistemologically or whatever, but like listening to an audiobook, you're getting the same, you're getting into the story. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I like books a lot more than movies. There's a reason, because your imagination works. With a movie, your imagination doesn't work. It's just kind of hand fed to you, okay? But when you read a book, like if you're going to read Lord of the Rings, you know, you have to imagine what Sauron looks like, right? Your imagination, based on all of your past experience in life, is going to be tapped into while you're reading these words and is going to work. You're going to have your own image of Sauron and these other people and these places, things like that. So reading fiction is, in my opinion, healthier than watching a movie, because watching a movie is just pure, pure, pure passivity. No intellectual activity is really going on there, you know? Audiobooks are really good. Mm. It's the same thing. Audiobook, you're being taken into the story. Your imagination is working. It's really nice. It's calming, extremely calming. And you get into it because you're into the story now.
Mm. But that's only for books. Like people could do other things, you know, like I know someone that paints.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
It's a beautiful thing. It's not too taxing, you know, on, like you said, you want to relax before you go to sleep. You don't want, you know, your brain to be in 1,000 places.
Yeah.
You know, some people paint, some people pick up different, hobbies that they never thought they would be into just because they were expanding outside of what else could I do. I know someone that started to put together puzzles. Honestly, I'm not joking, you know?
Yeah, there's a couple months I just started doing that, actually.
Yeah. So, like, thinking outside of it, you know? I know Father Andy had a few phases, too, with making those weird boxes.
Those are cool.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
So I know what you're talking about. I haven't done one myself, but I've seen his. They're awesome, those things.
So do you guys think it's wrong for someone like me to just want to turn off? You know what I'm saying? And to just do that, to just go into that world. You know what I'm saying? Like, do you think it's wrong for someone to do that, or it's not healthy, or that someone should never do that?
Everyone needs to relax. Like,
I know, but what is relaxation?
But what is relaxation? What's true relaxation? Because look at what he's saying. He's saying he does that and then he doesn't feel relaxed.
I don't feel relaxed. And I keep thinking I'm going to, but I don't.
Okay.
Thank you, my therapist.
I mean, with that, it's the thing to recognize is that this is not an easy question to answer.
Yeah.
It's hard to draw a line somewhere.
And it's very relative to each person,
mm-hmm.
honestly. You could say a lot of things that are objectively wrong, like binge scrolling and stuff. That's for sure objectively wrong. But some people relax by just sitting there in silence, you know, sitting outside in the backyard or whatever.
But yeah,
playing with the kids or whatever.
Sitting there in silence, is there a moment in time during that period of silence where there's true non-activity? I don't think so. I think there's always something happening intellectually. To completely turn off intellectually is to stop being a human.
Yeah.
So that's bad.
We're not meant for
that. You know?
Yeah.
But if you're, let's say I'm going to turn off, I'm laying in my bed or something, I'm about to go to sleep, preparing myself for sleep. And I don't know, some people maybe listen to music.
Hmm.
What kind of music? Is it, fruitful for this person? Is it, like I said, bringing out more of a human side in this person while they're turning off from other kinds of activity that's happening previously in the day? You know what I mean? So like, yeah, turning off or leaving the majority of the kind of work you're doing, kind of, you know, leaving that aside and then setting aside a certain point of time in your day to kind of do more leisurely things, you know, with a more virtuous disposition. That's good. That's good for a human being. That's a balance for human life. But to completely like stop anything intellectual, which means I'm not thinking about anything, I don't even know how you do that.
You just mitigate it, I think.
Well, I mean, the closest thing to that is mindlessly scrolling through TikTok.
No, but basically. What about...
You know what I'm saying?
What about after finishing a hike or a workout or whatever? Things like that.
Like...
The pressure sort of goes down with...
Uh-huh.
I mean, your mind being so chaotic with a bunch of things. I know if I'm in a boxing session or whatever, it's taxing physically because it's tough, it's hard. But mentally, I mean, I know that gives me a good balance.
Like you need
with
to
this
have a
life of chaos that
yeah,
I have.
Yeah, you need to have a time you know? For the mind to
yeah.
wind down.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons.
And rejuvenate.
And I think, yeah, exactly. I think I got this from you. So I usually do a walking rosary and I caught myself walking very fast back and forth. I think we were doing it one time, Rosemary.
You just kind of like walk fast in general.
So, I do, yeah.
So you apply that.
So then I just slow down my walking. And again, it helps your mind, obviously not shut off like you said, but it mitigates the chaos that's, you know, happening.
Sorry, you know, another thing, I think like the doom scrolling, like just mindlessly scrolling through TikTok or Instagram reels or whatever, I think it takes away a lot of necessary time for self-reflection that you could do in quiet time. Again, not turning off your brain, but using it for something that you can do in quiet time when less active work is being done, you know?
Yeah.
And self-reflection is a hard thing to do.
There's the Buddhist, I'm not like even close to an expert on this, but I'll say what I think I know. The kind of like Buddhist monks, Nirvana is when they have emptied themselves out of all thought and passion, right? When they just go to utter like nothingness, and that's when they're at peace. That's the understanding of peace in like high Buddhism, you know, which is not really human because for a human being in the Christian understanding, it's when the human being is fully engaged in doing the noblest goods, right? And the height of the human person is the mind. It's the intellect. It's what separates us from the animals. And so when the mind is fully engaged in the greatest activity, then the human being is being most himself and is the happiest if he's well ordered. And that would be like especially worship, right? Because you're using your body, kneeling, standing, sitting, etc., making the sound of the cross, doing the thing, and your mind is engaged in the activity that's going on right now, which is the worship of God. So that's that.
And if you take that further, you could say that is because the intellect has dominance over the passions. Mm-hmm. Whereas with that Buddhist example, like, we're not meant to eradicate our passions, but we're meant to have dominance over them. And this is a result that I'm able to use that intellect because I already have my passions. I already have control over my passions. I'm able to do A, B, C, and D, mm-hmm. you know, or else you can't get out of that, whatever, for lack of better words, that funk,
yeah,
you know, that you're in.
Yeah. So I think that's a good measure on whether or not the activities that we engage in are good for us or not. So like turning off, or like when we were talking about escaping this reality to go into another reality, like the metaverse. I'm never going to put on VR.
Dude, I tried it one time with Father Peter.
Yeah.
I don't know if he still does it, but
I've never done it.
One time he was at the St. Michael's house like a couple years ago. And he had just gotten it, or somebody was letting him borrow it or something. And I tried it, and it was freaky, dude.
You know, the name is freaky. Augmented reality.
Yeah.
There's a lot to say just about the name.
Yeah.
One of the things this makes me think about, like, if we're going to get more towards like a Christian understanding of this discussion, is the reason why I like Brothers Karamazov so much, which is the whole Grand Inquisitor scene.
Yeah.
So, you know, Jesus is engaged in a dialogue where he's being questioned about his mission, why he's doing certain things and not others. You know, especially with the temptation scene in the wilderness between him and Satan. You know, why not just feed everybody, turning stones into bread? Why not? That would really, you know, take away the hurdles that you would have to go through for your mission. But that's not Jesus' spirit. That's not Jesus' mentality. To take that shortcut and skip over the reality that he has to face, that's part of his mission, to demonstrate his love, to demonstrate his sacrifice, to give the human being the prime example of what it means and looks like to be a human being. And the same thing goes for, you know, throwing himself from the pinnacle of a temple. Why not? So that you could demonstrate your divinity at the end of the day. Now, why would you go to the cross, the medicine that shows us why we need to engage ourselves fully in reality? Like Father Ankita was saying, the human being is at his most human when he's engaging himself fully, especially utilizing his spirit, his intellect, to let himself be transformed by the reality that he has to face rather than escaping it, leaving it on the side, shutting it off. So when you get to the cross, which is again the fulfillment of Jesus's mission that's being pointed to at that point of the temptation, when you get to the cross, it kind of sums it up all right there.
So this is how I see, because like I think you mentioned it earlier too, drugs. Mm-hmm. Drugs is just to let me escape this reality and go into another one of my own making, one that's more pleasing. You know,
so dopamine, right?
That's dopamine.
It's like a drug.
Exactly, to run away from the cross, which is like the kind of you know, a difficult reality of this life.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not in essence, I don't think even like drug use is that much different than just binge watching shows or like, what did you call it earlier? Doomscrolling?
Doomscrolling.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah.
Welcome.
I mean, there's an extreme way and a, you know, evil way that people, because, you know, watching TV, going on social media in itself is not bad unless you abuse it, right? But there's a very bad way that people do it, which is through pornography.
Yeah, it's like alcohol. You can drink alcohol. I mean, they're, you know, you can moderate it and you can temper it and things like that. You do it in a good, ordered way, but you can always overdo it. And some people will be very tempted to overdo it constantly because they want to, it's a form of escape.
Yeah. So now we're posed with a question that, I mean, people would ask is, okay, how could I relax actually? You know, is what we're saying just a fantasy that no one is able to attain? Or, you know, when I finish a 11-hour shift and I get back home, what do I do, you know? And sorry, go ahead.
Or a student has been studying all day for a test and now you want them to go read?
I think,
you know,
sorry. I'm not ready to jump in.
Sorry. I think this is at least my opinion on it, is if evaluate what you're already doing in your life for quote unquote relaxation. What do you do? You know, name them, write them down. Look at each one of these categories and see how they're making you a more virtuous person. Are they adding more to your life that's good, or are they destructive? Then I think after answering those questions, someone could say, how can I stretch myself even more to build up better habits, to sort of think outside of the box and see, okay, what are other things I could do except these things that I'm so molded to and used to? And I think someone could develop, again, I've met countless people that said, I just sat down and thought for 5 minutes what else I could do. They picked up things like painting and
puzzles,
whatever. Something very innocent, but it could go a very long way, you know, with someone's intellectual capacity and virtue.
Yeah, honestly, I don't want to be shy about this. I would really challenge people to tell them, like, hey, last 2 hours of your day, get rid of the screens. Get rid of the screens, pick up a book, pick up painting, write a poem.
Are you talking to me?
You know?
Sit in the backyard.
Look me in the face.
Yeah. Say it to my face.
You're not shy. Say it.
What is that, subtweet?
Yeah,
I'm subtweeting.
Subtweeting, yeah.
But like, really do that, like get into a novel. Why not? Like, you know, people will look forward to their shows at the end of the day. They want to know what happens next, whatever. I do that with a novel. I mean, you know, read a novel and wait for the story to go on at the end of the day after you've had a long day at work. I'm not telling anybody, get rid of all your social media, get, you know, cancel your Netflix accounts and, you know, throw out the PlayStations or whatever. I'm not, but have a good balance. So for human beings, you know, a human being is most engaged when he's using his highest faculties to do the greatest good and to use them for the objects that are the greatest good. Then I don't think we should ever really turn off, actually. I think we should always engage it in good things, you know? And storytelling is one of those really, really good things.
So, sorry, there might be somebody who is studying all day, working all day, and they want to spend their last couple hours of their day with some kind of leisurely activity, restful activity, whatever you want to call it. Nothing wrong with going, having a meal, a drink with some friends, hanging out with some friends, having good conversation with some friends. If you're a parent, though, should it not be joyful or restful or refreshing to go and spend time with your kids after working or, you know, studying or whatever you're engaging with yourself with all day? I mean, let's say you are a parent. Let's say you do have friends. Your kids. I mean, I don't know what else to say what else there is to say about that, but...
Or your spouse.
Spending time with your kids or your spouse.
Your spouse. Yeah, put the kids to sleep and then chill with your spouse for, you know, the last hour or whatever it is, you know?
Yeah, if the kids are at that age where they're not relaxing.
And if you can't find a way to make sense of that or to find refreshment and joy with your kids or with your spouse, there's a problem there.
Yeah.
That has to be dealt with.
You're running away from your vocation.
And I'm glad you brought that up, by the way, the aspect of there's nothing wrong with hanging out with friends and going out to dinner or something like that. Because I think that could solve a lot of people's problems if they have the right friends. If you have friends with the same mentality and the same sort of virtue, the goal of virtue, I should say, that you desire as well, that could change a lot of things, you know?
Like what you were saying, I think reminded me, you know, like what you guys are both talking about, of what you were saying earlier about if it's a good thing, start doing it and then you're going to start enjoying it, you know?
Yeah.
Like with the guy and his wife and kids.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, maybe he wants to go and do something else to relax, but the best thing for him to do is to stay home with his wife and kids. And the same thing could apply to us as priests. You know, I've felt this too. Like the more you give to the people you serve and the more time you spend with them, the more you're gonna like enjoy being with them too.
That was me in seminary, you know, for adoration.
Yeah.
I had to, the first week I joined the seminary, I'm like, all right, I guess I have to do this, you know? and I was grinding my teeth and I had to get through it and I had to force myself to do that good thing. And now it's something that I desire and I feel like I lack, I'm missing if I don't have it.
I had that experience with the rosary. I had the hardest time getting into the rosary. It's very repetitive.
I still have it.
You know? Yeah, it's very repetitive. It's like hard to do for 15 minutes because it's so repetitive. It feels like it takes forever, right? But now it's like, it's my favorite prayer to do. It's so relaxing. I enjoy it. I feel like I'm really into it, etc. You know, I love doing it now, but it's because somebody told me, you know, a lot of people, the whole church really told me that this is a good thing to do. So I didn't see it as a good thing for me, but I was like, well, but the church is saying that it's a good thing to do. Let me conform myself to that and then just practice it until I get good at it. And that's what happens.
Proud of you, man.
Oh, thank you, so, brother.
You know what happens through this whole process that you guys are talking about right now? If something is good, start doing it. Mm. It opposes the tendency to keep creating for yourself.
Oh, that's good. Yeah.
So this allows you to be recreated. Instead of you imposing your creative tendency to keep doing this and keep doing that on your own, for your own entertainment, for your own pleasure, for your own kind of a mindless relaxation or a mindless kind of entertainment or creation, this is allowing you to kind of break yourself down a little bit in a good way, to be transformed. But I think the better word is to be recreated.
I think, and correct me if I'm wrong, a lot of, you know, science says that to avoid, you know, having Alzheimer's or dementia or things like that, or maybe pushing it further back, people at a certain age are required more to engage themselves in things that require memorization, reading, some intellectual activity, you know? And I think, and again, that's a sort of secular thing, but there's a lot of truth behind that. It speaks for itself. They're advising you, you know, physicians are advising you to do that for a reason.
Yeah.
And, you know, it goes to show how many mindless things could sort of cripple a person mentally.
Yeah, and I don't think we're meant to live that way mindlessly. And I think that's becoming more and more just the status quo of people today. Because technology, which is good, technology is good if it's used in an intentional manner, in a smart way. You know, if it's used to enhance the gifts that were given by God, wonderful. But when it drives us away from those gifts and it's eating away from those gifts because of just entertainment and this sense of this kind of false peace that comes with distraction, I think that it's eating away from our person, you know?
Like even this show, which is good, and I think a lot of people are benefiting from it, especially the kids' Bible study that you just started. I'm pretty sure that's going to be a success.
Inshallah.
If this starts affecting like our sacramental ministries, I doubt that it would keep going.
Yeah, exactly. You know? Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Even though it's a good purpose. Yeah.
But I like what you said actually earlier, which you have to, you're saying you have to keep creating yourself, right? And I think what you mean by that was you have to keep finding something to fill that gap, or you have to keep finding something to distract yourself with because you're not actually being formed into anything, right? Because you're kind of living mindlessly, you have to keep finding something to entertain yourself with, right? But the way that I guess my advice for people, and I try to do this myself too, I'm not great at it, but think of the person that you want to be, and then take all the steps intentionally to become that person or inform the habits. You want to be a reader, you know? When I was in seminary, I was like, okay, I didn't read books very much before seminary, but I said, I want to be a reader. I think I'd be good at that, you know? You want to be a reader? Just set the goal and then start reading books until it becomes a part of who you are. Instead of living mindlessly where you're constantly, like you said, you're constantly, you don't have any direction and you're just kind of picking at straws here.
Like I think the human being, part of our flaw is to have a tendency to want to make something out of nothing, which is God's prerogative, and that's God's duty, and we try to do that and it's in vain. But when you allow yourself, like, if I see something good and I don't know why it's good fully, I haven't felt why it's good. I haven't experienced why it's good. But let me, like, kind of allow myself to have some, you know, plasticity. Like when you're talking about neurons, they're able to learn and adapt to, like, new information. Let me allow myself to have that flexibility to learn something, to depend on something else outside of myself, so I can be a little bit, you know, broken down, and let this thing kind of put me back together, transform me into something better, something new. It's kind of really cool, honestly, if you think about it, that this is the whole mission of Jesus, is to usher forth a new creation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You can't do that if someone is not willing to admit a fault and to relearn something to become something better.
Or at least give it a shot.
Yeah.
Like, you have nothing to lose. Like, Father Andy, as weird as he is, you know, like, the guy started to get into watches and the mechanics of it, and he would, you know, get a small screwdriver, open them up. I get it's something funny, but it could be something, you know, a virtuous thing to do, you know?
Or he plays, like, sometimes, you know this, Father Andy will just play, like...
Yeah, he plays music.
He plays I don't know what those instruments are called. He's got an oud for
ukulele?
Sure.
Ukulele?
You know?
What's it called?
Ukulele, yeah. I don't know. He's got all the string instruments,
he's
you know?
He's so weird.
Yeah, yeah. But he'll just sit there and play, like, church hymns at night. It's nice. That's cool. I think that's awesome.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. That makes you more interesting.
Yeah. Mandolin.
Mandolin.
You called him weird. I called him interesting, for the record.
Both.
Okay.
Both
we'll see if he's watching, because he'll send us a text.
No. By the way, he claims that he doesn't watch the episodes he's not in.
Okay, we'll see about that.
In reality, he's rewinding over and over.
Maybe he's playing Zelda now instead of watching.
What would he be doing now? 228?
He would be complaining about why we're not eating yet, definitely, if he was here.
Yeah.
Which, speaking of...
And he would do this.
Let's get to it.
Yeah.
All right, guys. I can see the best Father Andy impression, man.
Eating a protein bar in his car.
All right, let's eat.
Real
food. Let's eat.
Wow.
Oh my gosh.
Don't eat it, bro.
This is...
Shawarma Fuego. Shawarma Fuego made us some great... I mean, a shawarma place, but they make incredible burgers and adobada tacos. So thank you guys very much.
So their service is just catering only?
They cater, yeah. They're outside right now.
We have napkins.
We do.
Wow.
Thank you. Wow.
Thank you, Azizi.
You're welcome, Habibi.
So these are autobata tacos?
Mm.
They're very flavorful.
Mm.
I like the crisp.
Oh, yeah.
Mm, with the burgers? I was going to say, like, I'm going to try to make my life changes right now.
Mm.
Okay. But the one thing I have to do is, after a Padres victory, I scroll, bro. Videos and interviews and, like, tweets. It's the funnest thing, man. After a victory, just to soak it in,
especially,
you know?
Especially with the Dodgers.
Especially with the Dodgers, man. Shout out Michael Barber. I mean, we've shouted him out a million times on the show. I don't know if he's ever even watched one episode. But
if you're going to the game this week or throughout the rest Dodger of the fan. Playoffs, please stay classy, San Diego. Do not be like the Dodgers fans.
Mm-hmm. Michael Barber's a great fan, great person. Very, very respectable man.
He's an exception.
He is, yeah.
That's for sure. Yeah, there's no words needed for this food.
Honestly. This is a great burger.
This is unbelievable.
Man. What a burger, dude.
Really?
What a burger, man.
Like, I want to take some to go.
I mean, there's a lot.
So only catering, right?
Yeah.
I've seen them at a few gatherings, like people's houses and stuff.
Sorry.
Please. Do you guys like mushrooms on burgers?
Not really.
Me too. I have to take them off.
Not really, but
I'm one of those.
I was okay with these.
I'm eating it for the experience, you know?
Yeah.
I don't mind them. If it fits, it's good.
I don't like mushrooms in general, man.
Texture?
You know?
Yeah, texture.
What about truffle?
No. Not a big fan of truffle, dude.
No truffle?
Sometimes there's like, you know, expensive truffle mac and cheese and stuff like that. I don't even want to smell it.
I don't mind it. Like, I'll eat it and I'll enjoy it, but it is unnecessary.
What, truffle?
Yeah.
Have you had that truffle? Oh, yeah. You introduced me to that.
Truff sauce is actually good. Certain
It's called truff?
It's called truff, yeah. Certain flavors of them. Like, the red one, I think, is good.
What?
Nothing.
Why are you looking at me in, like, disappointment?
You know what?
Care to share?
No. No words needed.
So are we going to continue the conversation we were having before we started filming? Or that you guys were having? You want to wait till after?
I don't mind.
Wait, can I say a fun fact about Father Danny that I learned last week?
Oh, come.
Last week?
Come on, dude.
Only last week. Can I say it?
Yeah, say whatever you want. I have nothing to hide.
Father Daniel, when he eats, the food cannot touch his lips.
I feel like I've heard that before.
Why?
No, since I was a kid. Like, if so I'm eating, like, with a spoon,
when you're, oh,
I don't take the food off with my lips.
That's so cringe, man.
Why, though?
I don't know. I'm not normal. I don't know. What do you want me to tell you? I'm weird.
What about ice cream?
No, I bite it.
Do you bite popsicles?
Yeah.
Like, straight up?
Mm. Oh, I don't eat popsicles. I don't know. I'm just thinking about the
I'm just thinking of foods that, like, you need your lips to eat, you know.
Like a hot dog? No.
Okay. Hey, to each their own, huh?
Okay.
Does that make you happy?
No, no.
You said it.
Bro,
there.
No.
Go ahead, guys.
No, I got one that you're not going to...
The whole world is watching.
You're not going to answer yes to this one, bro. Soup. Well, what the heck do you do with soup?
No, do you soup? Like, no. You slurp it. It's barely like...
Or noodles. Like that. Like, so you're eating ramen. No, same idea, soup.
If I have to... I don't think about it. Guys, I don't know. Let me videotape. Let me
how
record.
How did it come up? Were you watching him?
We had lunch.
We had lunch.
And all the guy was doing is staring at me.
Because I was bewildered, bro. I mean, look, I saw him do this. Okay. I was like, what are you doing?
So now that you mention it, I've noticed that too without noticing it.
Oh. Thank you. I guess I'll do one more talk.
Are you serious?
No, like, that he mentioned it, it triggered like, you know, deja vu kind of. Yeah, that's true, you know? Thanks for finally being brave enough to speak out on this issue.
By the way, my uncle always made fun of me since I was a kid because I would do that with chips. Or just maneuver.
Hey, there's worse habits to have, you know?
Go Padres.